Relationship Enrichment Center, all those who are watching us via the internet, we welcome you on Torah night. This is Thursday night, and we're teaching again on the Torah portions that we have on a weekly basis. If you are interested in finding out those Torah portions, we have them on our website also. If you go to our website, you see Torah portions, a tab, click into it, and you could actually download the Torah portions that you are supposed to study for the year. We're studying a new year, we're in the book of Genesis. And last week, because of Thanksgiving, we didn't have Torah study. And we were supposed to cover Genesis 28. I want to go with, if you could go with me to Genesis 28, those who are watching and those who are here with us tonight, let's look at Genesis 28. And let's look at a couple of things, because we're going to move into Genesis 37, the Torah portion for this week. And it's about Jacob's life. And how many of you know Jacob's life is very interesting?
Amen.
How many of you know that? Very interesting, his life. And but I just want to share a couple of things on this. And it's so cool how God always brings the word out and in his Torah portions. If you go to Genesis 28, we're going to look at Jacob's ladder. People are probably familiar with Jacob's ladder, but I'm going to just talk about a few things in Genesis 28. If you're in Genesis 28, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, let's go to verse 10 of Jacob's ladder. Verse 10. Praise the Lord. Meanwhile, Jacob left Beersheba and traveled towards Haran. At sundown, he arrived at a good place to set up camp and stop there for the night. Jacob found a stone to rest his head against and lay down to sleep. I don't know if you ever put your head on a stone to sleep. Anybody?
No.
I mean, the closest thing that I've ever done was my helmet. When I was in Vietnam, you know, when we landed on a place called Chu Lai, never heard of Chu Lai in my life. You know, and you could train as a Marine to do all these things. You see John Wayne movies, but I never thought I was going to be landing on the beach of Chu Lai, you know, amphibious assault. And in the middle of, almost in the middle of the night, and they bombarded it very, very, very intensely before we landed. And we got there and we secured it, we secured the area. Okay, most of us had to take we had to do a 24-hour guard rotation, but at night especially. And so, you know, it was my turn to go to sleep. And at least 4 hours, and then somebody would wake me up and I have to get up and do guard duty, right? And I go, when am I gonna sleep? I had nothing to sleep on. It was a beach. And basically all I had to do was put my pack down, and I said, well, the helmet is supposed to stay possible. So I laid my head on a helmet. And believe it or not, I was so tired, I fell asleep. Oh, yeah. So I could imagine what Jacob had to deal with putting his head on a stone. All right, so let's stay with me, all right? Stay with me. Let's look at this. And so in verse 12, as he slept, he dreamed of a stairway. Imagine putting your head on a stone and sleep and dreaming at the same time. That's incredible. And then he says he dreamed of a stairway that reached from the earth to heaven. And he saw the angels of God going up and down the stairway. At the top of the stairway stood the Lord. And he said, I am the Lord, the God of your grandfather, Abraham, and the God of your father, Isaac. And the ground you are lying on belongs to you. Everybody say the land.
The land
belongs to us. You know that.
Amen.
Even the land of Israel belongs to us.
Amen.
And even the land that you're in right now, we're standing on holy ground. This is the land that God gave us, r.e.c.
Yes.
The
Amen.
Camp of flour. This belongs to us.
Amen.
Right? The fruit stand and Brandon belongs to you. Wherever you dwell belongs to you. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
That's your land.
Yeah.
So we're going to look at this tonight. What do you do with your land? Okay? And verse 13, at the top of the stairway, the Lord said, I am the Lord your God, and this is again, this is your land. Your descendants in verse 14 will be as numerous, almost the same thing that God gave Abraham.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So he said, your descendants will be as numerous as the dust of the earth. They will spread out in all directions. Wow. Already prophesied that we were going to be scattered throughout the world.
Yes.
And he says, okay, and then he said, and they will be scattered to the west and the east and to the north and the south. And all the families of the earth will be blessed through you and your descendants.
Amen.
Almost the same prophecy he gave Abraham.
Yes.
Now, it says, but what's more, I am with you. Everybody say, God is with us.
God is with us.
Amen? I am with you. And what did he say? And I will protect you wherever you go. One day I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have finished giving you everything I have promised you. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
How many of you know God's promises are true?
Amen.
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 All right? How many of you know that? Verse 8:16 said, and Jacob awoke from his sleep, and surely the Lord is in this place, he said.
Amen.
I wasn't even aware of it, but he was also afraid and said, what an awesome place this is. It is none other than the house of God, the very gateway to heaven. So in other words, wherever you put your feet on, you can actually have the gateway to heaven.
Amen.
Everybody say amen?
Amen. Amen.
All right. Now, I want you to write some words down just to kind of make a point of this Torah portion. We're going to get into the, try to do the other Torah portion too. Now, I want you to write the word Yatzah.
Yes.
Yatzah. Yatzah. All right? The word yatsa, which means to go out, to leave, to die.
To what?
To leave. Are you going to leave someplace? To die. So the word yatsa means that when you leave, watch this now. Everybody say, I'm going to leave. My old nature.
My old nature.
All right? Everybody say, you're going to leave your old nature.
Leave my old nature.
All right? When you go, when you die, when you leave your own, it means that you have to die to it. Everybody say, have to die to it.
Have to die to it.
Right? In other words, okay, I want you to say it. Say, when I leave my old nature,
when I leave my old nature,
and I die to it,
I die to it,
then I enter into the light.
Then I enter into the light.
You cannot enter into the light in your own nature.
Amen.
Amen. Say amen.
Amen.
Understand, favor of God does not come into your life in your old nature.
Amen.
Only comes into your new nature.
Amen.
Only in obedience. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Okay? Now, let's move down. I kind of read some of it already, but let me kind of go a little bit quicker. Now, it's interesting that Jacob goes to by tradition, known as the Temple Mount. If you understand, when we go by tradition, we go by the Temple Mount, Mount Moriah. And again, that's where Abraham sacrificed Isaac. Mm-hmm. And we have Jacob following the steps of his forefathers, and the same promises that God gave Abraham is given to Jacob. Now, this is a holy place. This is how the Hebrews look at the holy place, Mount Moriah, as a holy place, the gate of heaven. Listen, where is Yeshua coming back? And when Yeshua comes back, he's going to come back where? He's going to go back to Israel. He's going to go back right to that mountain. He's not going to come back to New York City. Trust me. He's not going to come back to Ybor City. He's going to come back to Israel.
Amen.
Right? He's not going to come to Rome.
Uh-oh.
Amen.
The Catholics may think that. He's not coming to Rome. It's not in the western part of the world. Now, also notice the Torah, this Torah portion. It mentions of a ladder, right? The word ladder. Now, when you see the word ladder, you say, well, okay. Now, the word ladder here has a different definition, as you know. The word ladder here is also the word for Torah. the word for Torah. Alright? Which really represents the tree of life. That's why, as always, if you look at almost every Torah scroll, every cover of the Torah scroll has, if you look at our Torah, it has a tree of life on it.
Amen.
Who's the tree of life?
Yeshua.
Who's the walking Torah?
Yeshua.
Make sense?
Amen.
I say amen?
Amen.
Alright. But the ladder, okay, let's look at this in both ways. It represents the Torah, but let's look at John, the book of John chapter 1. John chapter 1 and verse 50. John 1 verse 50. And keep your finger at verse 28. We're going to go back there. In John chapter 1 verse 50, he said, Yeshua was speaking, he said, do you believe this just because I told you I have seen you under the fig tree? Will you see greater things than this? He said, you will see greater things than this. Then he said in verse 51, I tell you the truth, you will see heaven open and angels of God going up and down on the Son of Man, the one who is a stairway between heaven and earth.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So there's a cross reference to what we just read, isn't it?
Amen.
All right? So the ladder is the tree of life, the Torah, which is Yeshua.
Yes.
All right? Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Okay. Now, in verse 50 and 51 of John, write this down. This represents, write this down, the walk. In other words, your walk. It all depends on your walk. You cannot be going up and down that ladder unless you have the right walk.
Amen.
Because Jacob had to wrestle with God, and he got dislocated, didn't he?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right? In other words, his walk changed.
Amen.
In other words, people saw Jacob in a different light. Yes. They saw Jacob walking one way, and all of a sudden he's walking another way.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
So that's what God, in other words, people have to see us walk a different way.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
And we're getting into a season of idolatry. And this Torah portion and the one following is dealing with what idols you have. Mm-hmm. Say amen.
Amen.
Alright? And in other words, when you walk with God as if you are walking up a ladder, well, doing what? When you're going up a ladder, what is that called? Aliyah. Say aliyah.
Aliyah.
Aliyah is Hebrew for going up. I'm going over. The rabbis say that the ladder, the Torah, is a bridge between heaven and earth. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
It's a bridge between heaven and earth. So the actual Torah is the ladder that God is referring to in Genesis. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Now, so actually, you're going up. When you're in the Torah and you walk and you're operating in the Torah and you're obeying His commandments, you are actually going up the ladder. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
When you are not, then you're going down that ladder. Mm. Remember, how many of you know, we all know in the world, especially the business world, you know, when I work for Procter & Gamble, all they talk about is moving up the ladder.
Right, yeah.
They didn't say moving down the ladder. And he said, I want you to join the company so you can move down the ladder. No, you're going to join the company and be the top salesman so you can move up the ladder. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Okay? All right. So actually, we're going up the ladder because, again, we're walking with God. It's Aliyah. So just like Jacob, we are called to walk with God in a new walk.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right, I want you to write this down. The fear of divine punishment. Watch this now. How many of you know in the Greek mindset, sometimes we fear punishment. Right? If I don't do this stuff, God's going to punish me. I do this, oh, God's going to punish me. If I don't, you know, how many of you, come on, sometimes a Christian walk is something like that, that we're afraid of. God's going to kill me. God's going to punish me. That's not the kind of God we serve. It's
gonna,
amen. Don't think that. That's not the kind. We serve a father.
Amen.
Okay? He's not a slave master, a hard taskmaster. He's a father.
Amen.
Right? He's a deliverer. His whole goal is to deliver us.
Yep.
Yes. His goal is not to punish us. Mm-hmm. So get that mindset out of that. Right? So the fear of divine punishment is rooted where? Write this down. The fear of divine punishment is rooted in self-interest. Mm. Now watch this now. That can also become an idol. In other words, you are still fearing God or how he's going to divinely punish you? Is that the kind of God we serve? Come on, you know, am I always afraid of what God's going to do to me if I don't do all the right things? No. If you live that way, then you're not living in Torah.
Amen.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
But the truth is that you should be what? Focused on what? His holiness?
Yes.
Everybody say God's holiness?
God's holiness.
Say, I'm going to focus on his holiness,
not
God's punishment. All right? All right? Now, I want you to say this with me. The Spirit of Yeshua, come on, say it with me. The Spirit of Yeshua
is reverence
with results.
With results.
Okay? It's reverence. In other words, it's, you know, the word sometimes is chooses fear, it is reverence. Right?
Amen.
So when your heart is formed, come on, in God, your spirit is inspired.
Amen.
Come on, everybody say amen. So when my heart is formed, in God, my spirit is inspired.
My spirit is inspired.
Right? You should always have that inspiration of where you are with God.
Yes.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
You should know who you are.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
All right? Okay. So let me kind of go in now. Let's go to Genesis 37. To get into this tonight, I just want to give you that little foundation. There's a lot more to cover on that topic. We're going to do it next time. Genesis 37. Genesis 32, I should say. 32. Genesis 32. Genesis 32, that's the next quote. Genesis 32. If you're there, say amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right? Now, this is also, the Torah portion is called Veshaleach. Everybody say Veshaleach.
Veshaleach.
Veshaleach means almost like an ambassador. Mm-hmm. And it means he's sent. Veshaleach means he's sent. In other words, let me see if I can write it down. Make sure I spell it correctly. Veshaleach, okay? Veshaleach means he's sent in Hebrew. Alright? Now watch this now. Let's study Jacob a little bit more. His name is Yaakov in Hebrew. And again, when you go to this Torah portion in 32, let's read the first few, let's start with verse 3. Then Jacob sent messages ahead of his brother, to his brother Esau, who was living in the region of Seir, in the land of Edom. He told him, give this message to my master Esau. He calls him master, and that's not. Humble greetings from your servant Jacob. How many of you know that they, Jacob and Esau had a little problem?
Amen.
That's chivalry rivalry. Esau represents today Arabs, all right? And Jacob represents the people of God. I'm going to be known in Israel, and there's a controversy going on between Israel and Islam, or the Arab, right?
Yeah.
Okay? Same heritage. How many of you have, in your family, have chivalry rivalry? I don't know. Everybody has chivalry rivalry somehow.
Amen.
Some way we have some. We don't get along with all our brothers. We all have that Uncle John, we don't want to see him only once a year.
Yeah.
And even that was, you know, we kind of avoid him as much as we can. You know, we always have that. You know, Sister Ethel. You know.
And Doris.
Right? We always have that. You know. So how many of you know that spirit is still here?
Yep.
Amen.
Right? Come on, I'm still inheriting the spirit. Now, I want you to write down something, false god. I want you to write false gods. False gods. Because I want you to look at this, because we're getting into this now. False gods. All right? Now, Jacob had almost completed, if you look to build from where we were in chapter 28 till 32, Jacob completed his round trip that began 20 years earlier. By the time we get to 32, it's about 20 years that passed. He asked God to guard him and provide for him, and how many of you know God did? And he looks like, you know, it looks like Elohim, basically, you know, if you look at it, if you study it, the whole of this chapter, I don't have time to read every single chapter. But if you study Jacob's life, God provided for him greatly.
Amen.
Amen.
Come on, everybody say amen.
Amen.
And anything that, you know, I think Jacob will probably ask God, God will give it to him. Mm-hmm. Now, in Genesis 32, he's a very, people don't realize he's a very rich man. He's very rich right now. God has blessed him. As a matter of fact, he had two wives. I don't know if that's wealth.
Yeah.
Having two wives? Some people can't deal with one. But he had two wives. And and he had two concubines on top of that. Amen? I don't know how he did it. And he had 11 sons. He still had a couple of things which must be taken care of before his journey can be called complete. So one of these is meeting his brother Esau. Now he has to face this guy, because how many of you know, Esau said, if I see you again, I'm going to kill you.
Mm-hmm. Well, you told it. Amen.
And having your brother, I'm going to kill you. And last time Jacob saw Esau, they were not on the best of terms, of course. Deception or not, Jacob had taken the birthright. You know that, right? Mm-hmm. And the blessing of his brother. Esau was at best, how many of you know he was a bit ticked off?
Amen.
And wanted to kill Jacob. Splitting his family and herds into two groups seemed a bit cowardly, but he did not have faith that Yahweh was going to be with him. So Yahweh had not proven himself. Come on, you know, like in other words, why did he have to divide everything he had? Was he trying to manipulate things or not trust God totally? Come on, everybody say, I have to trust God totally. Some of us have a plan A and a plan B.
Right. Amen.
Come on. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
You know, we have a plan A. Well, I have plan A, but if plan A don't work, God, I got a plan B here.
Yeah.
Right. Amen. I'm going to figure it out somehow. I'm going to get something done. Amen. Come on. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
And you're going to have to know, God wants you to deal with plan A, not plan B.
All right.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
So here, Jacob, again, was basically doing something. And remember, plan B, write this down, plan B is always an idol. Plan B. Plan B is always an idol.
Whoa.
Wow.
It's a substitute.
Mm-hmm.
It's not God's best.
Amen.
You want to say amen?
Amen.
All right? All right. So there was one other issue Jacob will have to deal with. And that was what? When you have a plan A, okay, write this down. If you have a plan A and plan B, what is that? Trust.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You have a trust issue.
Amen.
You either trust God or you don't. Exactly. You're not trusting God for right now for a big blessing. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
I'm trusting God. I'm throwing a big blessing. Amen?
Amen.
And trust me, I'm human just like everybody else, and sometimes I'll be lying if I say, well, I have a plan A, I trust you, God. But let me see if I can get a little plan B here just in case.
Right.
just in case, you know. Just in case, and God is saying, whoa, you trust me or not?
Amen.
You trusting me or not? So I got to trust God. Amen. All right? Now, what are these false gods? What are these false gods? Simply put, false gods are plan B. A false god is something you keep with you just in case plan A does not work. For Rachel, I don't know how many of you know, for Rachel, she had been holding on to false gods. You understand what she was doing?
Oh, yeah.
Since he left her father's house, what it tells us is that she never really had total faith and trust in God.
Amen.
She was holding on to plan B just in case, like many of us do. Now, you and I may not have a bunch of little idols, so I got rid of my Christmas tree, I got rid of all that stuff, I don't do that no more. But you'd be surprised how many idols you still have. And look at me. Come on. In other words, you may be bowing down to fear. You may be bowing down to anxiety. You may be bowing down to doubt. You may be bowing down to your money, your IRA. You may be bowing down to, how much money you have in the bank. You may be bowing down to your job. Am I reading somebody's mail here? Huh? Are you bowing down to these things? How about your secret bank account that nobody knows about? How about that stash you have in the mattress?
Have you been in my house?
How about healthcare insurance? Well, I got healthy. Watch this now. Don't get me wrong, I believe in having IRA and I believe in having all these things and having insurance. I believe in that. But we cannot be materialistic.
Amen.
Sometimes we put plan B in place of God.
Amen.
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 All right? And the list goes on. You could probably write a list yourself. But I'm going to show you something tonight that I am a little bit, I need you to make you aware of what's going on. Let me just tell you what's going on in the state of Florida. Never mind, I'm watching, got their own eye. They got their own plan Bs, NCs. None of them work. Are you watching about? They don't work. Put God first. Put God first, sir. Amen? Things will work out. Alright? Now watch. Satanists. There is a Satanist church. You know that, right?
Oh, yeah.
Let me read this to you. This is in today's paper. Satan's holiday display at the Capitol in Tallahassee. In the Capitol of Tallahassee, they're having equal rights, and Satan, the Church of Satan, is putting up a display
for Christmas
to combat the nativities and the Christmas stuff. And they're allowing it. Opening up a door to, again, more judgment. Let me read it to you. A year after rejecting it, a grossly offensive during holiday season, state officials have approved a diorama of a fallen angel, in a way, how many of you know the devil always exposes himself anyway?
Right. Yeah.
It's a fallen angel falling to hell. Well, that's true.
Yes.
There is a falling angel falling to hell. That's where they're going to end up.
Yep.
That's right.
So they're having this display, and they're having it at the Capitol's ground floor at the rotunda of the Capitol in Tallahassee. And they basically are allowing this, and this is a doll, meant to represent an angel, appearing to fall from the cloud, made out of cotton into flames, and then it had flames. Some painted it on the back of display, and again, it will be on display from December 22nd to the 29th. Now, also a banner from Freedom from Religion Foundation is going to be put up. A small frame nativity scene from the International House of Prayer. So they put a little nativity scene there too. So in other words, everybody has their equal day. Because now we have to be politically correct. And politically correct is from the pit of hell.
Amen.
That's amen.
Amen.
Right? Now, it says here, and you can read on, but basically, they're having all kinds of stuff that they're trying. And one guy by the name of Chad Stevens of South Florida wants to place a 6-foot, it's called Festus, pole made out of past blue ribbon beer. For the holiday. So now I want you to think about this for a second. Look at, this is Satan, the church of Satan. It's in the capital. That's where we are. That's the mentality of the world today. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
So this Torah portion is right on. Talking about idols.
Amen.
All right? Now, so God is saying what? You know, we're holding on to false gods that we shouldn't be holding on to.
Amen.
Right. You know what? And to me, you know, God is God. And, you know, and I believe God is fronting and all this, but God is saying, you know what? They could do whatever they want. They could play. They could display all the false gods they want. But I'm the I am, the I am.
Amen.
And at the end, I'm going to win anyway. So, you know, you could put up whatever you want.
Amen.
You know, but the point is, this is what's happening. You know, we serve, everybody say, we serve the God of Abraham,
God.
Isaac, and come on, and Israel.
Israel.
Right? And we have to trust in plan A. Say plan A.
Plan A.
Not plan B.
Amen.
All right? So, let's look at this tonight. I want you to write another word down for me called Yasav.
Yasav.
Yasav. Yasav. Yasav. Which means to sit. To sit. To dwell. To live. And to settle. The word Yasav. Because if you look at even Yeshalak, you know, if you look at that word, which means to be sent as an ambassador, right? If you look at this, well then, you know, what is God saying? We hear saying one thing, we have to know where to settle. Everybody say, I'm going to settle in the right place.
You're going to settle in the right place.
All right?
Amen.
So in other words, if you add the word to yourself, if you have the word rosh, which means what?
Head.
Right?
Right.
Yes.
All right? Rosh. If you add that word to it, then you have to say, wait a minute, I have to proceed, and I am sitting as a chairman for God, at the head of God. Come on, everybody say the head of God.
Head of God.
Not the tail of God, the head of God. Say, I'm the head.
I'm the head.
You're not the tail. Say, I'm not the tail.
Not the tail.
All right? Unless you're sitting on your head. Now, understand something. It's very important what I'm going to share with you tonight. All right? There was a mindset. I want you to write this down. Democracy. We all know about democracy. Write down the word democracy. Democracy, where do you think that comes from? Democracy. Democracy, where do you think that comes from? Huh?
Greek.
It comes from what? The Greek mindset.
The Greek.
It's all Greek. in Hebrew, like the word Hebrew. Hebrew is the opposite. The opposite. Theo means what?
God.
In other words, you have a head, a leader. Moses was a leader. Theocracy. Okay? Theocracy, which means you have a head, a leader. Like Moses was a leader. It also means to sit under a leader. Oh, a wise man. You don't want to sit under someone that's giving you false instruction.
Amen.
You want to sit under a scholar.
Yes.
Listen, if you don't have someone as a spiritual leader, come on, that teaches you the truth, and we have a lot of people out there that don't have one. They may be teaching, they may be a so-called spiritual leader, but are they teaching the truth? Are they adding paganism to their teachings? And right now, we're in the season, it's all going to play out. And it's getting worse. Now we have the Satanists involved. And they're going to display their sign of God. Because to them, that's their God. Satan. All right, let's go back to Genesis. Let's go to Genesis 37. Let's kind of skip a little bit. I'm going fast because I know we missed last week, so I've got to catch up some stuff here. Alright? In Genesis 37, verse 1. Let's go there. So Jacob settled again in the land of Canaan, where his father had lived as a foreigner. This is the account of Jacob and his family. When Joseph was 17 years old, he often tended his father's flock, and he worked for his half-brothers, the sons of his father's wives, Bilhah and Zilpah. But Joseph reported to his father, some of the bad things that his brothers were doing. How many of you know the sibling rivalry between Jacob and Esau followed him?
That's right.
Even with his children?
Amen.
Generation of curses, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay? Notice in verse 3, it says, Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day Jacob had a special gift for Joseph, a beautiful robe. But his brother hated Joseph. Watch this now. Write this down. Every time you have favor of God, you will have hate and envy.
Amen.
When you have the favor of God, somebody will envy you and try to trick you to fall. Or, again, talk about you or whatever.
Right. Amen.
Amen. When favor comes, come on, all these things, unfortunately. You say, wait a minute, I want favor of God, but understand, envy and jealousy
come to them.
Will come along with favor. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Here, Joseph was having favor. And what was happening? Jealousy, envy, hate. Now, it talks about a robe. Now, if you, the robe that they use, believe it or not, I have one. I don't wear it because it's so hot. I perspire a lot. I don't want to wear too much underneath. I like to be free. But it's called a katan. That's the robe they actually use. A katan. And because if you look at verse 2, it says that and Joseph reported to his father, but then he said in verse 3, he gave him what? A special gift, a beautiful robe. And again, you know, you can look at robes in different ways. But if you go back to the Hebrew mindset, they use what is called a katan. All right? A katan. Everybody say katan.
Katan.
Now, the coat is, check this out. I want you to understand something. This coat drove his brothers to jealousy. A coat. Because that was a, in other words, that was a final confirmation that the main blessings were going to be with Joseph.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep. Amen.
Normally, what someone wore will describe his authority back in those days. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, Yeshua was known to wear a one fine, it was not pieces, it was all fine-tuned linen robe, plus Amen. His tallit, and it was all one garment piece. It was not separated at all.
No seam.
No seam whatsoever. It was made perfectly for him. And that was a sign of royalty. Now, so when the brothers, again, saw this, normally when someone wore a coat, especially a katan, is a sign of authority. Rabbis wear these as a sign of authority. Now, so when the brothers brought back, went back to Jacob, remember, what did they do with his coat? After they said that he died, they brought the coat back to his father. Well, they dipped it in blood, right?
Amen.
Now watch this now. Isn't that something? Stained in blood and ruined the coat? Now, what was the staining of the blood? I mean, you could say death or whatever, but write this down. Why do we stain things in blood? Because it was going to rob Joseph of his position and authority and assignment. Remember, the enemy will always hit you with something bloody to rob you of your authority, your position, and assignment. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Alright? In other words, so Joseph had a coat of a king and a priest. Now, when we go into Joseph, let's go into Joseph a little bit more. Because I think you know about Jacob, what was going on with his brother, and what happened with his brother. But thank God, you know, at least his brother and him parted ways in a sensible way. And how many of you know Jacob didn't get killed by his brother?
Praise Amen. The Lord. Amen.
But again, Joseph, well, I want you to write this down. Joseph is a picture of who?
Yeshua.
Of Yeshua. Right? Because first of all, they also took his priest's coat.
Yes.
And what? They tossed lot for it, right?
Yes, they did.
All right? And they had blood on it, didn't they?
Yes.
So, let's go to verse 7 of 37 Genesis. We were out in the field tying up bundles of grain. Suddenly my bundle stood up. Remember, this is a dream that he had. Let's go to verse 5 so you don't, I don't want you to lose track. One night Joseph had a dream. And when he told his brothers about it, they hated him even more. No matter what Joseph did, they didn't like him anymore.
Right.
Listen to me. Yeshua, can I be honest with you? Not too many people liked him.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
You know that? Right? His brothers turned against him, didn't he?
Oh, yeah.
Yeshua. Mm-hmm. And watch this now. Write this down. When I go to plan B, instead of plan A, you're also doing the same thing.
Oh.
Come on, everybody say amen.
Amen.
When you go to plan B, and now whatever idol, now you, guess what? You just murdered your brother. You just murdered the Messiah.
Amen.
Hello? Amen. That's why God delivered us from these pagan things.
Amen.
Because every time you start doing these, I just love it. It's just tradition. Well, be careful. Because those traditions are not really biblically based.
Amen.
God said in Genesis chapter 10, Jeremiah chapter 10, he says what? Don't do like the nations do.
Right.
And put an idol in your house.
Amen.
Right? And we're putting up idols all over the place. They're going all over. Right? Everybody say amen.
Amen.
So these are things that, again, this is a plan B. A plan B is idols. Now, if you look at these bundles, I want you to underline the word bundle. The word bundle here, in verse 7, if you go all the way down, We were out in the field tying up bundles of grain. Underline bundles of grain. Bundles of grain are sheaves. Sheaves. All right? Sheaves represent people in the field. Sheaves in Hebrew means, write this down, gathering. Gathering. Okay? So it means gathering and also means regathering. Sheaves were grabbed, when the sheaves were grabbed, the grain was cut off and put together, and the second person behind them set it up as stock. So they just kind of set it up. That's how they dealt with the sheaves. And they looked like almost like people in the field from a distance. Now, the other meaning of sheaves, write this down, meant that you bind all parts of your life together. When you tie these sheaves together, you are also binding your past life.
Amen.
Binding it. Come on, everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right? Are you seeing the meaning of all this stuff?
Yes.
And what do you bind? Hopefully, the gods that may be plan B in your life?
Yes.
The gods? Emotional? Maybe you're dealing with emotional scars.
Amen.
Financial scars. Physical scars. Spiritual scars.
Amen.
In other words, anything that bounds you in your walk with God. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
In other words, now, you remember the other dream, the second dream that he had. Now, if you go to verse 10, he says he told the dream of his father as well as to his brother, but his father scolded him. What kind of dream is that? Where your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you? In other words, they took it so differently. All right? Now, remember the second dream? Where the sun and the moon and the stars bow down?
Amen.
So Joseph's dream dealt with what? Like this now, heaven and earth.
Yeah.
What was Jacob's dream about?
Heaven and earth.
You see how it follows through?
Oh, yeah.
His father had the dream, heaven and earth. His son Joseph has the same thing. Jacob was blessed the same way Abraham was. Joseph is going to be blessed the same way.
Amen.
Which is a picture. Okay, write this down. The dream of heaven and earth, Machush Shemayim. It's called Machush Shemayim, which means the kingdom of God, all the heaven and the earth. Basically, is a kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is a picture that God wants you to see.
Amen.
Now, you will see that that Pharaoh's dream had only to do with world things. Remember?
Mm-hmm.
All right? So key number one, write this down. Key number one, Jacob settled in the land, even though he settled in the land, but he was what? His sons will be dispersed, right?
Right.
It's a picture of us, even though our forefathers settled in the land, but we were scattered, even though my forefather was settled in Israel.
Amen.
Like all of our forefathers were. So, this is a picture that I want you to see. And we were scattered throughout the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right? So after more than 20 years, Jacob digs in and settles. If you go to Genesis, go back 37, verse 1, Jacob settled again in the land. That means he was there before.
Amen.
He had to come back in the land of Canaan. But his father lived as a farmer.
Amen.
So he had to come back. Right? So this is a picture of what? 20 years later, Jacob digs in and settles where his father had lived. This is a picture, watch this now, write this down, This is a picture of you and I returning back to the faith of our forefathers.
Amen.
What we're doing right now, going into the Torah, studying the Torah, we're going back to the faith of our forefathers. The same picture that you see in Genesis 37. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right? Now, and that's prophesied. Where is that prophesied? In the Bible. Again, go to Malachi. What's the scripture? Malachi 4. You go to Malachi 4. Malachi 4:4. Remember to obey the law of Moses, my servant, all the decrees and regulations that I have, that I gave him, where?
On Mount Sinai.
For who?
All Israel.
All Israel. I mean, all of us. Come on. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
That means that we're all in the same picture.
Yeah.
It's for all of us. Mm-hmm. Not just for the Methodists. Mm-hmm. Not just for the Baptists. Mm-hmm. Not just for the Christians. Not just for the Jews.
Right.
It's for all of us.
Amen.
Look, I am sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord arrives.
Amen.
His preaching will what? Turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the children, hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse. In other words, it's about restoration. Say, gather, regather.
Gather.
Because that's the prophecy, isn't it?
Yes.
God's going to regather us.
Yes.
And regather, correct?
Amen.
That's why there's no rapture. It's about gathering, regathering. All right. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Okay. So this is the beginning. I see I don't have too much time. So this is a picture. If you look at Genesis chapter 37 and verse 2 and 3, let me just kind of break that up. 2 and 3, those two verses, if you read it, that's a picture of what? Of you returning to what? Yeshua. Joseph, remember, in other words, it's about returning. If you said Jacob loves it more than others, returning, say returning.
Returning.
All right? Returning Yeshua and the Torah. In other words, we're returning back to the Torah and who? Yeshua.
Amen.
The Torah portion is really about Jacob's legacy and his son, right? So you see Joseph, guess what? He intermarried. What do you mean he intermarried? Did you intermarry? Did you? Yes, you did. Come on. Every time you bought that Christmas tree, you intermarried. Every time you double Easter bunny, you intermarried. Come on.
Uh-huh.
We're saying that.
Amen.
We have idols, don't we do it, don't we?
Yes, we do.
Huh? Huh? Okay? And he married who? An Egyptian. Right? Joseph married an Egyptian, didn't he?
Yes.
Amen.
Right? He wasn't a Christian. All right. Now, let's put this in closing. Let's put this in daily application.
Okay.
Write this down. Write down my assignment is with Joseph. My assignment is with Joseph. In other words, as it is with Joseph, it will be with someone or something in your life that will cause a problem. Think about it. Joseph got tied up a little bit there, but God in the end saw him through. But how many of you know we sometimes got caught up and tied knots with certain things in life that got us into trouble?
Amen.
Now, how many of you, someone close to you with a problem, how many of you have somebody close to you or were close to you, there is a problem?
Yeah.
They are your thorn in the flesh. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Huh? And you find that in 1 John. Go to 1 John chapter 3. Oh my God. So much I can do. I'm skipping. 1 John chapter 3, in verse 17. If someone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need, but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person? In other words, you got to be compassionate enough to be sensitive to people around you.
Amen.
And sometimes, you know, we have people get to be a pain. Come on. It could be a pain and you want to just run. Mm-hmm. But sometimes we have to have compassion.
Amen.
Yes. Amen?
Amen.
So the point is what? That problems are not always bad. Problems are opportunities for God to show up.
Amen.
Because problems can actually be a good thing. Hello. You see, problems makes us reach out for each other. Come on, if you didn't have a problem, why? You know, I've been a marriage counselor for a long time, 20 years. If people didn't have problems in marriage, they would never reach out to me.
Right, amen.
Right? So if you have a problem, you get a chance to reach out to someone.
Amen.
So problems can actually cause you to reach out to someone that can help you.
Amen.
Amen.
All right? Joseph had problems. Jacob had problems. We all have problems. Come on.
Yeah.
See, I'm living with one right now. That's all right. Can I say amen?
Amen.
Joseph had problems. But problems, watch this, problems enables us to see the value of those close to us.
Amen.
And also enables us to see the importance as well of those close to us. Write this down. Please write this down. Never run from a problem.
Amen.
Hello? We open up tonight with facing the giants.
Amen.
Alright? You may be living with a giant. A giant problem. Never run from a problem. Always run to the solution. Because if you run from the problem, it will follow you. Now watch this now. How many of you know Joseph and us? Say us.
Us.
And Joseph.
And Joseph.
Go on. How many of you know Joseph was assigned to a specific group of people?
Yes.
You know that?
Yeah.
And he was assigned to a group of people just like you and me. It doesn't matter where you go in life. Watch this now. Like Joseph was even sent back to Egypt, remember? You will normally end up, come on, sometimes you may have to go back and deal with some of the stuff that you don't like to deal with. Sometimes you know what? But that's going to be your calling. That's where you're going to be. Remember what I said before. Whatever problems you have, or whatever, if you deal with something in your life that's really kind of is a thorn in your flesh, that thorn in the flesh could be your biggest blessing. Because if you overcome that, you could overcome any blessing. Mm-hmm. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right? But what we do, we run away from it. Amen?
Amen.
That's not the Hebrew mindset. In the Greek mindset, we run from darkness. I'm not saying to purposely run into darkness. But if darkness is there, by running away from it, it's not going to help. You're supposed to have the light.
Amen.
Put the light in that darkness.
Amen.
By running away from it, it's not going to help. Right?
Amen.
Okay, what does it matter to know history of Joseph if you cannot apply it to your life? Because if you understand Joseph, a forerunner of Messiah Yeshua, everything he dealt with, Yeshua dealt with, and guess what? We're going to deal with it. Because just like everybody hated Joseph because of what he had, we're being hated because of what we believe. Right now, for the holidays, people are not going to like it. Well, how come you don't put up a Christmas tree? Well, you're so high and mighty now. You're so godly. You can't be, you know, in other words, they look at you like you're some kind of freak.
Right.
You want to say that?
Amen.
Right? Amen. And don't be a tour of terrorist either. You got to go to those places. Sometimes you got to visit people with the trees and just ignore it. Just walk by. Praise the Lord, hallelujah, happy Hanukkah. People have to do their thing. Rabbi, how do I answer people when they say to me, Merry Christmas?
Happy Holidays.
I said, Happy Holidays and Merry Christmas and Happy Hanukkah to you too. And they go, in other words, you cover all bases. Amen? Cover all the bases. And you know, and don't be, oh, okay, have Merry Christmas. I'm a pagan. Don't do that. What kind of witness are you going to be? You're going to be a light. So just go along with it. And then when you say Happy Hanukkah, what do you mean by Happy Hanukkah? I said, well, I believe in Hanukkah too. Well, Jesus believed in Hanukkah. I said, really? Jesus believed in Hanukkah?
Yeah.
I said, yeah, don't you know it's in the Bible? Oh, no, it must be in the Old Testament. No, it was in John chapter 10. Read it. Come on, go with me, John. John chapter 10. I'm going to get into this a little bit. You got to roll my message on Hanukkah this year. It's about the end times. John chapter 10. Jesus celebrated Hanukkah. So you got to tell your families this. Verse 22 of John. It was now winter. And Jesus, hello folks, was in Jerusalem at the time of Hanukkah, the festival of dedication. And where was he? He was in the temple, walking through the section known as the Solomon's Colony. In other words, he was celebrating the temple's dedication.
Yes.
Which is what we are. We are celebrating, we are the temple of God.
Yes.
We have to celebrate the temple of God.
Yes.
Amen.
And every time you celebrate the Feast of Dedication or Hanukkah, you're celebrating your temple according to God. If Jesus, it was good enough for Yeshua, it's good enough for me and you. But most people don't understand this. They don't think it's for them. It's only for the Jews. No, it's for everyone. Matter of fact, nowhere in the Bible, show me in the Bible it says celebrate Christmas.
Show me.
You're not going to find it. Nowhere does it say celebrate Christmas. Hello? But it does say celebrate Hanukkah. Everybody say amen.
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 Huh? So what's your assignment? Write this down. Your assignment was determined and heightened. In other words, your assignment will determine and heighten what you see and hear. In other words, it will elevate what you see and hear. Your assignment will determine what, and again, lift what you see and hear. In other words, because the Spirit of the Kingdom of God will be upon you if you respond in the correct manner. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
In other words, what happened with Joseph, he was able to interpret dream when he was asked to serve the problem. How many of you know that, you know, you should be able to interpret dreams? How many of you have dreams?
Amen.
You should be able to interpret those dreams. Interpret them. I take dreams and I interpret them spiritually. They all have a meaning.
Yes.
Amen? You see, the problem, you notice, watch this now, I'll write this down. When you see a problem, the problem you notice is a clue to the anointing and the calling on your life. Oh boy, write that down, please. The problem you notice is a clue to the anointing and the calling of your life. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Did Joseph see a problem? Did he?
Yes,
he did. Did Joseph even see a problem with his brothers?
Yes.
And what did his brother do? Huh? Did they anoint him?
No.
Did his brother anoint him?
No.
They sold him out.
He was sold.
How many of you been sold out by your brother?
Oh,
or
yes.
Sister? Come on. Oh, mother or father, whatever. Right? In other words, watch this now. They sold him out. In other words, people will be sent, watch this now. You better write this down too. Because just the way the problem comes into your life, and that problem could be the clue to your, again, the calling of your life and the blessing of your life, But also, understand that this is something you have to face, and you have to face it clearly and face on. In other words, people, write this down, people will be sent to kill your anointing. There's always going to be people around you to kill your anointing. What is the anointing? The presence of God in you.
Amen.
There's going to be always someone around you. Just because they live with you doesn't mean that they after you. They may be out just to destroy your anointing.
Right. Amen.
Whoa.
Amen.
Sleeping with the enemy, that's a new meaning right there, bro. Right? Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Because, this is the way, you're always going to have people to discourage you and get you off track. Yeah. Always. You're going to have to learn how to deal with that.
Amen.
And see, and let me tell you something. You're going to need an anointing. What's the anointing? In other words, listen to me. You're going to need the anointing to deal with Christmas.
Oh, yes.
You're going to need the anointing to go shopping. Yeah. You're going to need the anointing to deal with problem people. Because if you don't have the anointing, that person will kill you. Mm-hmm. Or those things will kill you.
Yes.
Amen.
It will destroy your anointing. In other words, you got to say, God, the presence of God, please do not leave me now.
Amen.
Amen.
Do not leave me. Do not forsake me now.
Amen.
Because listen, and the greater the anointing,
the greater the attack.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm sorry. He said, well, I don't want no anointing. Well, then you're going to get more attack and you don't know how to deal with it.
Yep.
Amen. You lose either way.
Amen.
But you're gonna lose if you have greater anointing. In other words, how do you respond to a problem determine the blessings or the curse?
Amen.
Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Listen to me. You are not assigned to everyone. Please understand that too. You're not assigned to everyone with a problem. There's some people that have problems and they come and go to this ministry, and sometimes I just, you know, I feel that, you know what? I will help you, but if I see you don't receive what I have to say to you, I take my hands off you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to waste my time on someone that doesn't want to receive.
Amen.
So not everyone is assigned to you.
Amen.
Not everybody with a problem, I'm going to deal with it. You know, some people always go after stray dogs.
Right.
That everybody that's wounded, you're going to go after. Certain people you're going to have to know, keep your arm's length.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen? Especially if they're always asking you for money. Hello? Amen?
Amen.
Don't allow people to ask you for money. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Amen.
Because, you know, and sometimes, you know, and because again, we feel bad, listen to me. But you know what, I think the safe way to do it, and I think in any ministry, is that, Rabbi, this person, if a person from the church asks for money, you always come to me. Safeguard.
Amen.
Safeguard.
That's right. Amen.
Safeguard. Because there's people that are going to go after you for money.
Right.
Amen.
Right? We have benevolence. And can I tell you something? We don't give benevolence to everybody.
Amen.
Many people have come through those doors wanting benevolence and never come back.
Right.
Oh, they only come to get benevolence. Mm-hmm. And that coming for God or for the anointing of God.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
So you got to know when to give and when not to give.
Amen.
You got to have discernment. And when some people ask me for money, I have people walk in the store. I was walking over here one day, and a couple came over, you know, heavy set couple in a station wagon, crying with kids, and, you know, we need this and we need that. And I said, I'm sorry, but, you know, Metropolitan Ministries could help you. We don't have the availability, and first of all, our benevolence is just for people in the church that are tithing. People that support the church.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen.
We have it, but for people that, you know, and if somebody just comes to get, you know, you're going to have to say no. I know it's hard to say. You have to say no, no. I said, you know what? Before I do, I need to talk to the rabbi first, if it's okay with him. Because I know who's here, who comes and goes.
Right.
And I can tell you, don't give to that person. That's bad investment. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
Say that's wisdom?
That's wisdom.
Right? Mm-hmm. All right? Say, I'm not a sign.
Not a sign.
Everyone with a problem.
Everyone with a problem.
All right, now watch this now. Some problems are just impossible for you to solve.
Amen.
Amen.
I've learned that as a pastor, man, and as a counselor. Sometimes, you know what? I've given you the best scriptures, the best phone I could give you. If that can't help you, then you know what? Goodbye. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right, let me close with this. Write this down if you want to, but hear it most of all. Never breathe life into something God is killing or allowing to die.
Whoa.
Never breathe life into something God is killing or allowing to die. How many of you know it's not a good idea to breathe life into Pharaoh?
Right. Amen.
He had a hard heart. That brother would not listen to any advice from God, no matter what you told him.
Amen.
Have you ever given advice to people about God and how to do godly things, and they just do what they want to do anyway?
Oh, yes.
That's breathing life into something God is allowing to kill or die. Amen? An adversary or an enemy, listen to me, is brought into your life for you, come on, for one reason in your life. And that is to, in other words, when you have an enemy, when you have a problem, remember, if you deal with it correctly, you're going to go into another season.
Amen.
Yes.
If you don't, you're going to stay in that season.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
That's right.
Come on.
That's right.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. The Bible says that you should withdraw yourself, first of all, from lazy people. You don't work? Goodbye.
That's right.
Do you know what lazy means in Hebrew? Can I tell you what it means?
Uh-huh.
Can I give you one scripture before we go? Matthew, I gotta just give you the scripture. Matthew 9. How many of you know people are lazy? They don't wanna do anything. You know. You give them a scripture, but you have to read it to them. Show it to them, paste it in their forehead, explain to them in Hebrew and Greek, and give me a break. Read the Bible for yourself and see what it says. You can't lead everybody by the hand. Matthew 9:37. I think we're done, but I don't think I have any more time anyway. He said to his disciples, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest and ask him to send more workers into the field. In other words, the word few, right, the word few, in Hebrew is the word lazy. You ever see people that they have very few. You know, they don't.
Ambition.
There's no growth in their life. You ever see that people stay in the same mode? I ran into a lady the other day. In fact, a lady called me this week. There was somebody that she came to the church about 2 or 3 years ago, and she brought this person that I've known for years, and I could not believe that this person, when I saw him 10 years ago, scrabbly. Same old mentality, look like he's been living out of a garbage bag. Well, still in the same mode.
Same garbage bag.
Still same mode. They don't change. And I just said, ooh, stop right there, bro. I don't need this. I dealt 10 years ago, I dealt with you, I'm going to deal with you now. I see you haven't changed, and goodbye. Because lazy is the word few. And you find that in the scripture. Look up the word few and see what it says. is the word lazy. And God says, lazy people, slothfulness, God doesn't deal with. Amen. You got to be a hard worker. Everybody say amen?
Amen. Amen.
All right, let's pray. All right, put your hand in your spirit. I'm going to give you one last word of wisdom. Can I give you that?
Amen. Amen.
You must stay aware. You must stay aware that the attitude of a person with a problem is more important to God than the problem they are facing. Let me say that again. You must stay aware that the attitude of a person with a problem is more important to God than the problem that they are facing. In other words, turn them over to God.
Yep.
Give them back to the manufacturer.
Amen.
Isn't that your assignment? Sometimes you can't help them. You can't.
That's true.
I'm pretty sure you're working with people. How many of you work with people that you know what, they are lost cause? No matter how much you try, no matter how much you pray for them, you know, just say, Father, I turn them over to you. That's what God had to do with Pharaoh. Moses couldn't deal with Pharaoh.
Right. Amen.
Moses, yeah. God said, you know what? I'm not going to leave with him either. I just taught him his heart and let him die. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right? That's really important if you understand that. So Father, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
We thank you tonight for your blessings.
Thank
you for your word.
Thank
you for your word of encouragement. Father, we thank you that we are walking up and down that ladder. We're walking more up than we're walking down. Father, we thank you for what you have given us. We thank you for the Torah portion. We thank you for the knowledge and instruction of your word. And we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. In the name of Yeshua, be with us this year and every day of our lives. Father, we are believing for the Shemitah year, for a breakthrough year, a jubilee year. Father, we're trusting in you. We have a plan A. We don't have a plan B. We're going to trust in you no matter what. And we're going to put all our cares upon you, oh God. Because you care for us, oh Lord. So, Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We give you honor. And we glorify you tonight. In Yeshua's name. And all God's people said amen.
Amen.
Come on. Put your hands together and give him praise. Amen.